Good morning, church. It's good to be together today. We're celebrating the promises of God on this beautiful, beautiful day. Our call to worship this morning comes from the psalmist. Give unto the Lord, O ye mighty. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Sisters and brothers, let us worship our God.
Let us join our voices and hearts together as we pray the prayer of confession found in our bulletin. O God, deliver us from the burden of sin as we make our confession.
Remove the scales from our eyes,
pull
the yoke of the Lord.
from everlasting to everlasting. In the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Presence among us, and if you are watching online, we're so glad that you're here as well. I want to remind all of you to fill out your connection card. It's attached to your bulletin, and if you're online, it's right above the live feed. You just click on the button that says connection card, and it will fall down into your screen. There's an opportunity to share prayer concerns on the back of the connection card. Please do that. If you check confidential, only our pastors will see those prayer requests, and if you check prayer letter, we will include it in the next prayer letter. Otherwise, our elders and deacons and prayer ministers will pray over the connection cards in the coming hours. It's a great joy and privilege for us to be with you in times of great joy and also of great sorrow. Also, lots of announcements in the bulletin as well. So want to point out just a few. Tuesday evening, we have a wonderful opportunity provided by the Urban Renewal Center, the URC. They are having an event in First Hall, 6:30 on Tuesday, called Sold Down the River, a unique and intriguing conversation with Dr. Cassandra Newby Alexander, who is a professor at Norfolk State University. So we hope that you will come and be a part of this. Norfolk has a unique relationship with the slave trade, so we hope that you'll come and learn more about the history of our city and how it is we can respond to that. So please join us on Tuesday. Also, we're excited about a women's gathering next Sunday, May the 21st, for all ages of women, for a women's Italian-themed potluck. So bring some pasta, bring a salad, bring dessert, but just come. If you don't want to make anything, Harris Teeter has great food. Just pick some up and come and be a part of it. 5 to 6:30, wonderful time of fellowship and fun, so please sign up so we know how many tables to set up. It'll be a great time for us all to be together. And then also, summer's just around the corner, and our summer read this summer is Dream Big by Bob Goff. This is the book right here. It's available at the welcome desk for $10. It's a discounted price. We're able to get a good deal. So we hope that you'll purchase the book and start reading it. We'll start the book series on June the 4th. So this is just a way for you to get a little ahead. It's a wonderful book, and Bob does a great job of helping us figure out what Christ is calling us to do and how to live that out in our lives. So I hope that you will pick up this book. It's a great read. And today is the second Sunday of the month, and so it is time for our 10 cents a meal offering. So you'll see a basket on the floor near the center aisle. If you'll pick that up, our offering this Sunday goes to our Saturday soup kitchen, where we feed between 15 and 100 people every single Saturday to feed the working poor and the homeless in our community. So please pick up the basket, put your money in there, and then, and kids, if you brought your banks, go ahead and deposit your bank into the basket, pass it to the outside aisles, and our ushers will come by and pick those up. Once you pass the basket, please stand and greet one another. It's so good to be together.
Hello. Oh, excellent. Kids, come on up. And as we are waiting for the kids to come up for the children's sermon, come on up, Freddie. Come on up, Rhett. It's good to see you. It's a very exciting day. And before I get going on the children's sermon, hello. I would like to publicly congratulate one of my most favorites, Moira, who learned Psalm 23, and she has been so hard practicing it, and I'm so happy to give you your box of chocolate shepherd rods for learning Psalm 23. And so thank you very much. And for those of you that have not had the opportunity, like Richard Bray and Moira, to learn Psalm 23, you still have another week, and I have at least 10 boxes of shepherd rods. So first comes, first serve. You come up and you tell me the Psalm 23, and I will congratulate you with a gift, which is exactly what we enjoy doing here at the church. All right, so today is an exciting day, and I see you're on your best manners. And what day, what are we celebrating today? Hold on, what are we celebrating today, Moira?
Happy Mother's Day.
That's exactly right, and this is so exciting. It is so exciting that it's Mother's Day. And I want to show you that I brought something for Mother's Day. I brought a card, and it's not as fun to make fun of Arlie when she's not in the room. But I would like to say that this is the card I bought for my mother, not the one that Arlie gave me, because I am still waiting on that card. So we are going to have lunch today, and so I'm hoping that Arlie drew me a Mother's Day card, which will make me so happy. Did you get your mom a Mother's Day card? Wonderful. I figured two or three Mother's Day cards, and in the Mother's Day card, Freddie, did you tell your mother that you love her? Yes. And don't you think your mom loves it for you to tell her that you love her? But what do you think she loves better than you telling her that you love her? Maybe you showing her that you love her? Moira, how can you show your mom that you love her? So the 9 o'clock kids had some really interesting ways. What are some things that you can do to show your mom that you love her?
Be kind.
Yes, be kind. And how else? That's perfect.
Smart.
Yes, and you're all those things, right? And what about doing what has been asked of you? Like, I have a kid, I won't name her name, but she does not always do what I ask her to do the first time around, and sometimes I have to ask this particular child of mine several times to do something, and then eventually she'll do it either when I totally get upset with her or she'll do it after about 15 times, right? But moms like you to do it on the first time. And maybe even moms like you to do something without being asked at all, right? So this made me think about mothers and how mothers like to show love to you and like to you to show love to them. But who loves you even more than your mom does? And who taught us how to love, Freddie?
God.
That's exactly right. And God loves for us to tell us that we love him. But more importantly, he loves us for us to show him that we love him, and he loves for us to show us that we love him by loving other people, right? Just like our moms teach us on earth how to love each other, God teaches us in the Bible to love each other by serving each other and being together as brothers and sisters in Christ and doing things together and showing that love. So today I think it is a great reminder of how our mothers love us, which is a mirror on how God calls us to love each other because he loved us first. So I'm going to close this in prayer, and we are going to go make a special craft for you to give the person that takes care of you. All right, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord, and thank you for the privilege that we have to come here and to be in love with you, Lord. And we are so thankful that you have sent folks like moms and dads and aunts and uncles and all of those important people who care for us and show us what it means to love each other, Lord. We are so thankful that you have allowed those folks to come into our lives to emulate that Jesus' love for us, Lord, and how we should be behaving as Christians. And we pray that we will mirror that and act that out in our life today. In your heavenly name,
amen,
amen, Moira. Now listen, if you want to go to Children's Church, anybody who hasn't made their mother a Mother's Day gift can stand up and come with me now. All right.
Good stuff. Okay, We are still in our series on the 23rd Psalm, and I want us to read it together in the King James. So it's the easiest way to do that is on the cover of your bulletin. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Beautiful. Now, Gospel of John, the 10th chapter, we're going to pick up in the first verse. These are the words of Jesus. Very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he's brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they'll run away from him because they don't recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech for the Pharisees, but they didn't understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to kill, steal, destroy. I've come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. It's the word of the Lord. So in the next 20 minutes, I am going to lay out for you what I think are 90% of the challenges in today's world. So listen. And it starts with a story, true story. When Cheryl and I lived in the Shenandoah Valley, some of our dearest friends were Dan and Sue Woodworth. Dan was a local veterinarian, and they had a farm, and on their farm, they had a pasture with a pretty large number of sheep. And so Danny was, in addition to a veterinarian, was a shepherd. And I got a call from him one morning that was a little bit distressed in his tone, and asked me if I could get to the farm as soon as possible. So I dropped things, drove out. And what had happened is Dan was out in this pasture with all these sheep, and in the middle of the pasture was a big black cherry tree. And black cherry leaves, when they fall, when they're dead and fall, are okay for sheep. But if the green leaves are eaten, it just dissolves their blood and they actually die from it. So it was either a storm or lightning had struck the tree, and the tree was leaning down in many different pieces, so all these green leaves were out there. And Danny was doing his best to get his sheep away from the leaves, though they were attracted to it, and he just needed help. That morning, I learned more about shepherding than anything I've ever read or seen or imagined. First off, I learned that it is absolutely true that sheep know the shepherd's voice. It is also absolutely true that they do not know and will not follow a stranger's voice. It was astounding to me to see how he could call them and how he could cajole them into all kinds of things. There's a story told 40, 50 years ago in Palestine of Israelis coming into Palestine in a particular village and occupying the village. And when they did, they took all of the sheep, mostly shepherds, put all of the sheep in one pen. And so this little village had over 400 sheep in one pen, but all the owners were left without them. And a widow came up to the young Israeli soldiers and pleaded that she could she get her sheep? And they laughed at her, and they said to her, well, how many sheep do you have? And she said, I have 25. And so the young soldier said, well, I'll tell you what, if you can get the 25 to come out, just those 25, then you can keep them. So she left. She came back with her son. Her son walked up and he pulled out of his pocket a flute and he began to play. And within 5 minutes, 25 sheep, no fewer, no more, came out of that pen and followed that young man back to their pasture. It is absolutely true that they followed the shepherd's voice. It's also important to know that the shepherd never raises his voice. The shepherd stays calm. The shepherd stays peaceful. Sheep, even when they know the voice, do not like to respond to anger, to loud words, to loud sounds. Beautiful, beautiful story. But that morning, I learned too that shepherds have a tough job, and they are physical people. I watched Danny grab, shake, pull, throw down, pick up all kinds of sheep to get them to respond quickly enough so that he could save their lives, so that they didn't eat something that was going to destroy them. It's tough physical work of being a shepherd. And the third thing I learned, which is perhaps the great life lesson for me, is that a shepherd spends much more time protecting sheep from themselves than from any outside enemy. Now, our passage today in the 23rd Psalm is, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And we remember that, you know, it's a rod and a staff, two separate things. The rod is used to protect against animals, lions, wolves, bears, whatever would be attacking the sheep, to protect against the foreign enemies. But the staff, really often with a hook on it, is designed to protect the sheep from themselves, to be able to grab them by the neck, to pull them, to do whatever is needed. Now, in the context of the Gospel of John, Jesus is talking in this period of time to the Pharisees around the Festival of Lights, which we call today Hanukkah. So if you've been Jewish, grew up Jewish, if you have Jewish friends or you know, people, you'll realize that it's the festival that comes around December, usually close in proximity to Christmas. And it's called the Festival of Lights because the story is that when the temple was rededicated after it had been desecrated by someone, that they put in a candle, an oil lamp, and they had enough oil for one day. But the lamp mysteriously, beautifully, miraculously burned for 8 days, long enough for them to make enough oil to then burn the lamp forever. So it's this beautiful festival, right? It's got fun and meaning and all that's in it, dreidels, all that stuff. But in its context, much of what the Jews would be celebrating or remembering was the failed leadership and false prophets of their own people who had followed other people, other nations that were occupying them. And so it's a time when Jesus, as he starts talking about being the good shepherd, is talking about it collectively. He is the shepherd for the flock, which are the people of Israel, the Jews, for his people. When he says he is the good shepherd, he's the shepherd for them. When he says that he is the gate, the shepherds would actually, they would build a pen with stones, they would put up brush on top of it, and then they would leave the gate open. And the shepherds would literally lay down at night and sleep there so that no one could come or go without them being awakened. So when Jesus is saying this, that he's the good shepherd, when he says, I am the gate, he's saying it in a collective way. This is what I do for my people. But he's also talking about it individually. One of the great opportunities for shepherds is to create positive reinforcement, to use a voice without raising it, to be able to have calm things for the sheep to be able to see the goodness of the shepherd and to want to positively be reinforced to follow the shepherd. But Sheep also, from time to time, need a deeper love than just the positive reinforcement. They need correction. They need to be shaken, grabbed, twisted, turned, whatever it is to keep them safe. Now, you may recall, somewhere along the line, seeing a picture of Jesus as the Good Shepherd with a little lamb across his shoulders, right? Now, I've been to the Holy Land a number of times. Every time I'm there, I hear this exact same story. I don't know about its veracity, but I know every shepherd tells me the same story. That when you see a shepherd with a little lamb on their shoulders, what it means is that little lamb was a wayward one. She wouldn't listen, she would follow, she would go all these different ways, and her life was always at risk. So the shepherd goes, the 99 and the one, goes and collects the one, and when the shepherd picks her up, he breaks her leg and puts her on his shoulder. It takes 6 weeks for the leg to heal. And by the time he carries her for 6 weeks, when he puts her down, she will never go more than 10 feet from the shepherd. Now, I bet you wished I hadn't told you that story. The hardest part of parenting is correction. Amen? The hardest part of being a good parent is not to allow a child to make every choice they want. The hardest part of being a good shepherd is not to allow a sheep any choice that they want. And I suspect the hardest part of being a good God is not to allow any choice that we desire. Correction is an absolute necessity for there to be true and real love. Today's Hanukkah, the festival of lights for us, whether it's failed leadership or false prophets, what's going on in our context today is simply this. I think the greatest temptation for us as the followers of Jesus is to over-sentimentalize our God, to make our God into the loving, caring shepherd, the God who loves and accepts and who welcomes. And God does love and accept and welcome. But it is so tempting for us to take that, to sentimentalize that, to make it into something where ultimately we would say, my God wouldn't do that. My God wouldn't do that. My God is about welcome. My God is about openness. My God is about love. My God is about bringing in. And what we end up doing is that we create a God that's like a Disney God. Now, I can't really use that much as an illustration anymore because Disney's gotten weird. But I'm thinking about the old Disney days, right? When it was just sweet stories and everything turned out right and all of that kind of stuff. And so what we want to do is we want to create this sort of Disney God. The problem with that is that that God is ultimately flaccid. And ultimately that God cannot save. Because the hard work of love without correction is not love. There has to be a God. There has to be a loving shepherd. There has to be a loving parent who knows when it's time for them to be able to correct in the ways that we need to be corrected in order for us to be safe and to be saved. The other challenge in this, though, and I hope I can make this transition for you because this is absolutely critical. The problem with the Disney God, the sentimentalized, sort of the idea of this God who carries us on his shoulders and all these beautiful things, to overemphasize that means that all the weight is on us. Now, what I mean by that is that assumes that we are capable of figuring out on our own. I think the greatest threat in today's world is this. We are starting to live in a world where we say that choice is the ultimate good. As long as we can make choices, we're okay. And any choice is a choice. And if choice is the ultimate good, not choices, but if choice itself is the ultimate good, then any choice we make is okay. Any choice, we follow this, it doesn't work for us, we follow this, maybe it will for someone else, we follow this, we follow this. And we end up in this world where we are told, if you just make the right choice, if you just make the right choice for you, if you just make the right things for you, then everything's going to work. Everything's going to work out. And so we keep trying and we keep trying and we keep trying, and it's all on our shoulders. And there's no one there to help us to say, this is a better choice or this is the right choice, because it's just about choice. And when choice becomes the ultimate good, what happens is that when someone makes a choice that we don't like, we don't know what to do with that. Because choice is choice. But they make a choice that we don't like or we don't think is good, or at least good for us. And so what do? We cancel them. We live in this culture. We live in this world where increasingly we simply just cancel. We just cancel people. We cancel them because we can't deal with their choices. And we don't have anything objective that says to them, that choice is wrong. No, choice is choice. And so we just let it go. And so what we do is we cancel them, and then we start to live in smaller little worlds where people are kind of making the choices that we're making. And never do we discuss anything deeper than that. And when we live in this cancel world where things are canceled, and we do it with historical figures, but we do it with national people, we do it with our families, when there's a cancel culture, there's no restoration. You just cancel them. They're just out of your life. You just push them aside and you go on and live your life separate from it. Well, my friends, let me say this to you. God never cancels. Ever. God never sends out and says, abandon all hope, ye who enter here. God never does that. From the very beginning story of the first couple of Adam and Eve to the very end of this book is filled with people who deserved, by the standards of the world today, to be canceled, but who weren't. Moses was a murderer. Abraham was just a sleazy bum. What do I mean by that? He passes his wife off as his sister to go and make it easy for him. Twice he does it. David is a murderer. We look at story after story after story. People who in our culture perhaps would be canceled and sent off to the Netherlands, but now, not the Netherlands like the country, but the Netherlands. I've got a Dutchman here who I'm having lunch with later, and he's going to get on me if I don't correct that. Though, now that I think about it, no, never mind. But God doesn't. And his grace and his will is made known through these stories. Walter Burkhardt was a chaplain at Georgetown University for decades, one of the great preachers of the 20th century. He tells the story of two Irishmen in a pub, and they're in their Guinness, and then they move from Guinness and they get into their whiskey, and the longer they drink and the more intoxicated they become, the deeper their argument is. And the argument is over this. They are arguing over which one loves the other the most. And so the one drunk Irishman, I love you more. The other drunk Irishman, oh, I love you more. And they go back and forth and back and forth, ranting and raving, until finally one of the Irishmen looks at the other and he says, if you love me more, tell me this. What hurts me? And his friend says, how do I know what hurts you? I just know that I love you. And he looks back at his friend and he says, if you don't know what hurts me, you cannot tell me that you love me. Our God, my friends, knows not only what hurts us, but why. Our God does not desire for us to be better. Our God desires, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone. All new is here. All that is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Our God doesn't want us to get better. Our God says you can have a new life. You can be a new creation. It can all be made better. We very often think that life is about this. It's about falling and getting up. That's a heresy. Life is not about falling and getting up. Life for the believer in Christ is this. It's about falling and being gotten up. That's the staff of God. The God who pulls us up, the God who wrangles us, who puts us in the places where he knows we are most safe, where we can be the most trusted. That's what our life is to be. That's the call for us. It's Mother's Day. And happy Mother's Day. I have a story about my mom that I didn't like for a long time, but I'm going to tell it to you. So one of my earliest memories of my life, so I was probably 5, I guess. I don't know if that's the age when you start to kind of remember. I was sitting in the kitchen with my mom. We had just come back from the Quick Check, the grocery store. And my mom's putting away groceries, and I'm sitting at the table, and I reach in my pocket, and I pull out a pack of gum. Hadn't been opened, new pack. And I said to my mom, "Where did this come from?" And my mom's like, "What?" I said, "I don't know. I just reached my hand in my pocket, and I found a pack of gum." And my mom's like, "Okay, what happened?" Now, I didn't steal it, because I didn't take it off of the gum rack. I found it on top, this is absolutely a true story, I found it on top of a soup can in the soup aisle. I figured it didn't belong there, and it was anybody's fair game for me to take it. So I take it, put it in my pocket, I tell my mom that, here's the thing she did. She put the milk up, left everything else out. She grabs me by the ear, puts me in the car, holding on to my ear. She drives me to the Quick Check. And back in the day, I don't know if y'all are of a generation remember this, but you know, like the grocery stores were all just kind of like flat, except they had one mountain in it. It was that raised up thing, had a little glass kind of around the top, and it's where the speaker, the microphone was, so someone could say, you know, clean up on aisle 3 or whatever. And growing up in a little town, here's what was also up there, was like all the bounce checks. And so you're in a little town, and anybody that bounced a check, they would put the check up and write, you know, so everybody kind of act like they weren't really looking at it, but they'd say, "Oh, I know her, I know him," and all that. So my mom takes me in, holding my hand, not because she was being wonderfully loving to me, but she was making sure I was not going to run away. She walks up, she goes to this young woman who's got the microphone, and she says, "My son wants to talk to the manager." And in the other hand, she's got my hand here, and the other hand, she's holding up this piece of gum, this pack of gum. So this young girl, this is how I remember it, says on the microphone, "Is the manager available? Is there a manager here? This young boy, I think, has been up to no good. I think he may be a thief." This is how I remember it. I don't know. "And he is here to see the manager." So Mr. Brinkley comes up, kind of rotund guy. He's got his tie on, you know, kind of comes about down to here, you know, and he comes up, and everybody knows everybody. It's a little town. So Mr. Brinkley comes up, and he looks down at me. He says, "Yes, young man, why are you here?" At that point, my mom had let go of my hand, and she was off somewhere. And I stood before Mr. Brinkley, and I confessed my sin. And I was not real happy with my mom for a long time after that. Until somewhere in my childhood, I realized this. I talk about my dad and my Uncle Albert all the time. I talk about my mom, not simply because I love their stories, but I realized those were the people in my life who wanted one thing for me. They wanted me to be a better man than when I fell. They didn't expect me to be perfect. They knew that there was stuff in me they didn't expect, but they wanted me to be a better man than the last time I fell, I messed up, I did something wrong. And sometimes it was by love and encouragement, sometimes it was by a deeper love of accountability and correction. This is why, my friends, and listen carefully, don't judge me a heretic until I build it out. This is why we as Christians see sin as such a joyous thing. What do I mean by that? Well, we as Christians realize that we are all messed up. You, me, us, them, it. Isaiah says, though your sins are like scarlet, like red. We know as Christians that sin is a stain. It's a stain that comes upon our lives and it comes upon every life. Paul says, everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And this for us is perhaps the greatest encouragement in our life. What do I mean by that? because we know we're all messed up, but it doesn't have to stay that way. Isaiah that said, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. We believe that it's not just about getting better. We believe that there can be a new creation, that our sins can be forgiven, that life can be made fresh and can be made new. This is the promise that we have. And this is why for us, we have an answer. We have a way forward. It's not just trial and error, this or this or this choice or this choice or this choice. But we have a leader, we have a shepherd. A young preschool mom, her daughter's really acting up. She's really, really acting up in school, at home, all of that. And she says, I just think she's sinister. Now, I might want her to work on her word choice, but let me say this. It is a lot better to see the sinister in your preschooler than to wait for them to become an adult and the court system tell you their sinisterness. That's actually kind of funny, but maybe it isn't. It's true. And there's something for us when we believe and know that yes, there's sin. Yes, there are things that we do wrong. Yes, there is right and wrong. There are choices that are wrong. There are choices that are right. We get all of that. But the key for us is to know and believe that it doesn't have to stay that way. This breaking leg love is a love that God has for us, not simply to say, try your best, go out and play in the street. But it's a love that says, I will hold you accountable in the ways that will be right for you. This God of ours, this God that we're told in Deuteronomy, that he will go before us and he'll be with us, he'll never leave or forsake us. This God who we believe that all things work together for good, as Paul says. This God who tells us and loves us in these ways is a God who loves us enough to correct us. This is a God who knows not only the what, but the why of what hurts us. And this God wants nothing less than for us to be new creations. Back to my mom. My dad, the last, I don't know, maybe close to a decade of my dad's life, my dad struggled with dementia. And it got to the point, my mom didn't have the resources, but I don't know that she would have anyway. My dad stayed at home. He actually died in my childhood bedroom. My mom took care of my dad when he was aware and unaware, when he was physically able to move, when he wasn't. And it worked on her in a lot of ways. I remember sitting with her one night on the screened-in porch, South Carolina, in the heat of the summer in the evening. And my mom said to me, Jimmy, you know, there may be a time when, like your dad, I won't remember who you are when you come to visit. It was her greatest fear, to lose her mind. And I said, I know, Mom. And she said, if that happens, you have to remember for me. And I said, I will, Mama, I promise. She sat a while and she said, Jimmy, you know, there may be a time that will come when I won't remember who I am. And if that happens, you'll have to remember for me. I promise. Then she said, there may be a time when I won't even remember my God. And you'll have to remember for me. I said, I promise. And then she said the most wise thing I've ever heard from her. But if you forget, it's okay. Because I know he will always remember me. The sheep know my voice, Jesus says. But he also says, I know theirs. You are remembered
I have staked everything in my life, as messed up and as sinful and as broken as I am, by that one idea that I will always be remembered by my God. And I can say to you with steadfast confidence, my friends, that there is no better way to live and to love and to be, to know that you will never be forgotten, forsaken. You'll only be forgiven, and you will always be remembered. The love is hard. It's beautiful, and it's passionate, and it's healing, and it's sweet, and it's kind. And the real love is hard, because not only is it that, but it corrects us. It wrangles us. It wrestles with us. And it keeps us on the path that he desires us to be. May you find peace and love and deep love in our God. Amen.
Friends, now is our opportunity to respond to the Good Shepherd who knows our name. And as we follow him, we are asked to give of our tithes, of our offerings for his work, for his kingdom. So our ushers will come forward in just a few moments to receive our offering. I want to remind you that as you put your tithes and offerings in the plate, we also ask that you put the connection card in the plate as well so we can acknowledge your presence with us. If you're watching online, we encourage you to participate in the offering as well by pushing on the give button right above the live feed, or anyone can use text to give, and that number is 757-530-5683. Type in the word give, the amount you'd like to give, send the text, and it will walk you through the giving process. So let us continue to celebrate our Good Shepherd, the goodness of his love and grace, by giving of our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Gracious Father, we thank you for opening the way to us to be with you through Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that you would take these gifts and use them to bring your kingdom glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Christian, in whom do you believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ,
please be seated. As we move into a time of prayer, we want to lift up the brokenness in this world, especially Ukraine, Sudan, and so many other places. We have an opportunity to celebrate the goodness of God and new beginnings. There's a Mother's Day concert at Royster Presbyterian today at 3:00 that celebrates two Ukrainian refugees, Oles Samaga and Olina Marsavalo. He's a flutist and she's a pianist, and a wonderful opportunity. If you are available at 3 to go to Royster, we encourage you to go and be a part of this concert. So what a gift. The tickets are available, they're free, at the welcome desk. Pick one up and perhaps not only be blessed by the music, but be a blessing as well by your presence. We also want to lift up the mamas at the Joy Village and wish them a very happy birthday. The Joy Village is an orphanage that's outside of Nairobi, Kenya, that's sponsored by or supported by our Tree of Lives ministry. It's a beautiful, hallowed place, and we celebrate those mamas that have taken in 10 to 12 kids and raised them as their own. What a beautiful gift. And we celebrate all the mothers out there, whether they be biological or spiritual, and all the gifts that they have given to us. And we also lift up those who today is a difficult day, a day of loss, of surrender, and of pain. So we lift up all of these prayer concerns and praises in our hearts as we go to the Lord. I want to continue, in particular, pray for Kathy Honaker, whose mother died this past Monday. We also lift up our own Joel Phillips. He is in New Jersey now. His father is in the hospital. His mother continues to be in rehab. So lots of health concerns with his family, and he's able to be with them today. And so we pray for him and pray for his father, Rick, and mother, Suzanne. We also want to continue to pray for those who are in the hospital, those who are facing surgery, and also an opportunity for us. Our soul training exercise this week is silence and awareness of creation. So read this insert, take it with you, and practice a new practice if you've never done this. 5 minutes of silence and also being aware of the beauty of God's creation. Just a wonderful way to continue to be with our Good Shepherd in this season. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we love you. We are so grateful, Jesus, that you are our Good Shepherd. And we thank you for your rod and your staff that bring correction and comfort. We thank you that through your rod and staff, we come to know you more fully and come to understand ourselves more fully as well. We pray for those, Lord, that are far away from you. And we pray that you would use our lives as we learn to love one another and to love you, that you would use us to reach out to others, that they may come to know you and love you as their Good Shepherd. We pray, Lord, for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones, for those who today is painful and not joyful.
We pray, Lord, for your comfort and care to be with us. We thank you for the gift of being together, of celebration, of sharing joy, of being your children, Father. And we pray that as we continue to worship you, you would overwhelm us with your kindness and comfort and care. Hear us, Lord, as we call on your name, praying together. Our Father.
If you want to hold up anything in prayer today, come on up. Our prayer team's been praying for us throughout our time in our sanctuary. They'll be on the other side of the table. Give them the gift. You get the blessing of anything you want to hold in prayer. If you're with us for the first time, we've got a gift for you. It's a book by Rick Warren, a short little book, but it is great, called What on Earth Am I Here For? It's about purpose and meaning in life, and it is free. You don't have to sign anything or shake a hand. If you go out to the narthex, there's a little table up against the wall. If you go this way for coffee and pastries, there's a bigger table in the common area. We'd love for you to do that as well. I want to encourage you, invite someone to come and share an encounter, have an encounter with our living God. Invite them to come to worship. And now, sisters and brothers, live simply, love generously, serve faithfully, speak truthfully, pray daily. And here's the key to life. Leave everything to the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.